देन द इंटरनल ईयर और दैट इज कॉल्ड द लेबायरिंथ. सो द लेबायरिंथ और द इंटरनल ईयर इट इज मेड बाय द टू कंपोनेंट. दैट इज द आउटर पार्ट इट इज कॉल्ड द बोनी लेबायरिंथ एंड द इनर पार्ट इट इज कॉल्ड द लेबायरिंथ. सो हियर यू कैन सी दिस इज द इंटरनल ईयर. सो दैट इज दिस इज द इंटरनल ईयर एंड द फ्लूइड फील्ड into that the membranous labyrinth it is called the endolymph and the membranous labyrinth lies within the complex intercommunicating bony cavities and a canal that is called the bony labyrinth in the petrous part of the temporal bone. The space between the membranous and the bony labyrinth it is filled with the fluid that is called the perilymph. The sensory receptors within the membranous labyrinth are responsible for the hearing and the balancing or the equilibrium of the body. So let's see that is the membranous labyrinth. So the membranous labyrinth, this one, so it consists of the four parts. First, that is the cochlear duct. Here you can see that is the round part. It is called the cochlear duct. Then that is the saculae, then the utricle and the semicircular canal. So let's see that is the cochlear duct. So the cochlear duct, it lies within the bony cochlea. The saculae and the utricle, it should be lie within the bony vestibule. And the three semicircular canal or that is the three semicircular ducts, they are lying within the three bony semicircular canals. Then the four parts are interconnected with each other by first that is the cochlear duct. So cochlear duct, it is connected to that the saccule by the ductus renuans. So here then the saccule connected the utricle by a Y shape. Here you can see that is the Y shape utricosaccular duct. So here you can see that is the utricosaccular duct which expand to form the ductus and here that should be formed that the sac like structure. So that is called the ductus and the saccus entolymphaticus. This one. Then the utricle, it should be connected to the semicircular duct through that the five openings. So here you can see that is the five opening. Then to see that is the receptors from that is the four parts of the membranous labyrinth, let's see the another diagram. So here in this diagram you can see that is the receptors which are coming out from the different part of the membranous labyrinth. So the sensory receptors within the cochlear duct. So this one, it is a spiral organ of Corti. So here you can see that is the spiral organ of Corti and it is concerned with the hearing. So that should be enters into that the cochlear nerve and that is related with the hearing. Then the sensory receptors within the utricles and the saccule. So that is the utricle and this is the utricle and this is the saccule. This is utricle, this is saccule. And the sensory receptors that is from this saccula are the maculae. And it should be enters throughout the vestibular nerve. And they are concerned with the static balance. Then the sensory receptors within the semicircular duct. So this one, three semicircular duct are the crista ampullaris. So this one. And they are concerned with the kinetic balance which is passing through the vestibular nerve. So here. So that is the receptors from that is the utricle and the saccule. That is the utricle, that is saccule and from the semicircular duct. So that should be passing into that the vestibular nerve and related with the static balance and the kinetic balance. And the impulses or the receptors which is coming out from, that is the cochlear duct, that forming the spiral organ of Corti, and that should be enters into that the cochlear nerve, which is related with the hearing. Then the bony labyrinth. So it consists of series of intercommunicating bony cavities and the canals within the petrous part of the temporal bone. So it consists of, that is the cochlea, then the vestibule and the semicircular canals. These are three in numbers. So let's see, that is the cochlea. So cochlea, it resembles a shell of the common snail. It apex is directed towards the medial wall of the tympanic cavity, while the base, it is directed towards the bottom of the internal acoustic meatus. The cochlea, it consists of the central pillar called the modulus and the bony cochlear canal. So here this part, it is called the modular, and that is the bony cochlear canal. So this is the rounded part. Then the vestibule. So this one. So the vestibule, it is the central ovoid cavity of the bony labyrinth, present between the cochlea in front and the three semicircular canal behind. So that is the cochlea, and posteriorly that is the semicircular canal behind. It is lies in the medial to that the middle cavity. Then the lateral wall, this one, that is the lateral wall. The lateral wall of the vestibule communicates with the middle ear cavity by the fenestra vestibuli. So here you can see, that is the opening. It is called the fenestra vestibuli, which in life is closed by the footplate of the steps and the annular ligament. So here, that is the footplate of the step is attached with that the annular ligament. Then the medial wall, means opposite side to it. So here in this diagram you can see, that is the medial wall. So medial wall of the vestibule, it present the two recesses. That is, first it is called the spherical recess. So here you can see, that is the spherical recess. And second one, that is the elliptical recess. So this is the elliptical recess. So small rounded opening, it is called spherical recess, and that is the large oval opening like structure, that is called the elliptical recess. The two recesses are separated by a vestibular crest. So this one, middle to it, that is called the vestibular crest. Then the spherical recess lodges the saculi. So here, that is the saculi, that should be lodges. And the elliptical recess, it should be lodges the utricle. Then below to that the elliptical recess, there is presence that the small opening. That opening is for the aqueduct of the vestibule. So here you can see. And throughout this, that is the ductus endolymphaticus, that is also called the endolymphatic sac, and the saculus endolymphaticus. So that should be passing out throughout that the foramen. Then the anterior wall of, that is the vestibule, it should be shows, that is the opening, it is for the opening related to the scala vestibuli. And posterior wall, it shows, that is the five opening for the opening of, that is the three semicircular canal. So this one. Then after then, let's see, that is the semicircular canal. Then the three semicircular canal. So these three bony semicircular canals, that consist of the anterior, this one, or that is called the superior, this one, then the posterior and the lateral. So this is the posterior and this is the lateral. So they lie in three planes at the right angle to each other. And each canal is about the 2/3 of a circle, and it is dilated at the one end to form, that is the ampulla. So here that the dilated form, it is called the ampulla. First let's see, that is the anterior semicircular canal. So this one. So it lies in the vertical plane at the right angle to the long axis of petrous temporal bone. So it is convex upwards. So here you can see, and its position is indicated on the anterior surface of the petrous temporal bone. Then its anterior ampullated part, so this one, it communicates within the vestibule anteriorly, and its posterior non-ampullated end unites with the upper non-ampullated part of the posterior semicircular canal to form here, that is the crus communi, which opens into the vestibule. Then the posterior semicircular canal, so this one, so it lies in the vertical plane parallel to the long axis of petrous temporal bone. Its convexity is directed backwards, and its lower ampullated end, this one, communicates with the vestibule, this one, and the other end, it is joins with the anterior semicircular canal to form the crus communi. Then the lateral semicircular canal, so this one, so it lies in the horizontal plane, and its convexity is directed posterolaterally. Its anterolateral end, it is ampullated, so this one, and lies close to the ampullated end of the anterior semicircular canal. Both ends of this canal open directly into that the vestibule, so this one. Thus the three semicircular canals open into the vestibule by the five openings, so 1, 2, 3, 4 and the five opening, so that is the semicircular canal. So the clinical or the applied anatomy related with that the ear. The secretion of the ceruminous gland, it should be forming the accumulation of the earwax into the external acoustic meatus, and which is the often source of excessive itching due to that the fungal infection. Then the infection, second clinical point, the infection to that the ceruminous gland can occur the furuncle into that the external part of the acoustic meatus. Then third clinical point, the troublesome should be occurs when the large foreign particles, that is the seeds, grains or insect, that should be occurs the trouble into that the external auditory meatus. Then the infection to that the elastic cartilage, so here that is the redness should be occur, so this called the perichondritis, this one. Then the small piece of the skin from that is the lobule, this one, from this region of the pinna are commonly useful for the demonstration of the leprae bacilli to confirm the diagnosis of the leprosy. Then the next clinical point, the involvement of ear of the herpes zoster infection that infect the vagus and the facial nerve, which is present into that the petrous part of the temporal bone. So the examination of the ear with the help of the otoscope, so it is called the otoscopic examination. Then next to it, that is the boils and the other infection of the external auditory meatus causes a little swelling but are extremely very much painful, that is due to fixity of the skin to the underlying bone and the cartilage, and ear should be dried after the head bath or the swimming. Then the next clinical point, that is the otitis media. So the otitis media means that is the infection or the inflammation of the middle ear, and can be spread due to the microbes from the upper respiratory tract throughout the Eustachian tube. It is very much common in the children because that is the widening and the shortening length of the Eustachian tube, and that may be causes the perforation of the tympanic membrane and the purulent discharge from the
external auditory meatus that should be occurs. So that is called the otorrhea.
Next clinical point, that is the deafness of the ear that causes by many reason. Then to examination of the inner part of the ear, that is the ear pinna, should be kept or stretched upwards, backwards and laterally, because that is the auditory meatus, it is not the straight. And whenever you can pull it upwards, backwards and laterally, you can see that is the inner part of the ear. So the ear pinna, it is used for the grafting material, that is the cartilage present into that, the conchae and the tragus, that is also used for grafting, and the fat which is present into that, the lobule, that is also help for the grafting. Then the next clinical point, that is the hair present on that the pinna in the male, that represents the Y linked inheritance. So the perforation of the tympanic membrane, it may be result from the external injury or the middle ear infection, that is the otitis media. Then the examination of the tympanic membrane, the inspection of the tympanic membrane with the otoscope, that provide the significant information about the condition of the middle ear. So this is the malleus, incus and the steps, and the clinical point related with each, that is the hyperacusis. So both tensor tympani and the stapedius are contact reflexy and simultaneously to dampen very loud sounds, thus preventing the noise of the tremor to the internal ear. The paralysis of the stapedius result in the hyperacusis, that means the abnormally increase the power of hearing, where even the whisper appears as a noise. Then otosclerosis, that is here you know that is the foot plate that should be attached to that the vestibule. So the abnormal foot plate that is attached to that the vestibule through the annular ligament. So the abnormal ossification of the annular ligament which anchors the foot plate of the steps to the oval window is called the otosclerosis. This impedes the movements of the steps and causes the deafness. So otosclerosis is the most common cause of the conductive deafness in the adult. The next clinical point, that is the mastoid abscess. It is a common condition, that is the antrum. So here you can see that is the antrum is approached surgically through its lateral wall. Thus, it is important to access the limit of the supramaetal triangle. Then, the referred pain of the ear. Since that is the middle ear and the external ear are supplied by the branches of the trigeminal nerve, glossopharyngeal and the vagus nerve, the pain in this ear or the otalgia is often referred to the other areas which is supplied by this nerve, that means the tongue, teeth, tonsil and the pharynx. These are the clinical points related with the ear.